Okay. This is so Seattle. We start late and everyone's very respectfully quiet. It's very, it's extremely Pacific Northwest. All right, so my name is Ryan Kahlo. I'm a law professor at the University of Washington. I'm really excited to welcome you all here. This lecture by Cory Doctorow is being put on by the Henry Art Museum, by the DX Arts, which is a unit within the university focusing on digital arts, and by the Tech Policy Lab. And you can find out more about each of these things online. I hope you do. And we're excited to come together to bring you Cory. This is part of a series on surveillance, actually. And so you'll be able to catch more people talking about these issues in the coming weeks, people like Mark Rotenberg of the Electronic Privacy Information Center and others. And so it's a very exciting series that the Henry is putting together with DX Arts. And we're very happy to be able to participate today. So Cory Doctorow is a lot of things. He's an activist, he's an author, he's a journalist, he's an editor, he's a public intellectual. Incidentally, I've actually known of Cory, not known him socially, for a long time, since his days at Electronic Frontier Foundation, and I've always been a big fan. I read Boing Boing, and I've read his work before. But then I actually go and I have to read his bio in order to introduce him, and I was just like, holy shit, right? So it's like all these different things. So he's all these different things, an activist, an author, a journalist, an editor, and so forth. And not only is he all these things, but he wins awards, like multiple awards at each of the things that he does in completely separate, different kinds of categories, right? So best-selling, award-winning, science fiction author, but also just equally celebrated in all of his other endeavors. Meanwhile, all of this activity is taking place over approximately the last 10 years, right? And so it's not like we're talking about a lot of time. And this actually puzzled and mystified me. And then I remembered that TV show, Orphan Black. For those of you, right, okay, good. Only people who come to see Cory Doctorow would substantially know that I talk about Orphan Black. And that easily explains what's happening here, right? Yeah, and it's Canadian as well, which is helpful. So actually, Cory's giving lectures in multiple different cities at the moment right now, so please don't let me know that. All right. So his latest book is Information Doesn't Want to Be Free. I haven't actually read it yet. I have read reviews of it, which are absolutely glowing. I'm very much looking forward to digging into it. Cory has graciously agreed to sign this and other books, which are being provided by the University of Washington's bookstore outside after the lecture. So I hope you get a chance to get your book signed and to pick one up. Yeah, so I mean, literally every second that I talk is one less second you can hear from the man himself. So with that, Cory Doctorow, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you for that very kind introduction. It's my cup runneth over. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And yeah, not only will I sign things that you buy at the stand, I'll sign whatever you bring, provided it's not a check or a body part. So, thank you all very much. Thank you for coming out and braving the rain. I understand that there's some sort of local sporting match tonight as well. I don't really follow Pokemon or tennis or whatever it is, but I hear it's big here. I'm going to talk to you tonight about privacy, and it's kind of a big omnibus talk about privacy in the 21st century, especially after the Snowden revelations of last year. So before Snowden, I think a lot of people who were thinking about privacy in their heart of hearts suspected that they might be being a little paranoid. But after Snowden, I think many people have decided that they weren't paranoid enough. What Snowden showed us was that governments around the world, led by the NSA, adopted a doctrine that the head of the NSA was called collected all. And it means exactly what it says. Every chat, every call, every tweet, every update, every click. Store it forever. And it's hard to say why this is being done, although I think that's an important question to answer, because if we're going to do something about it, we need to know why it's there. The advocates say that it's about preventing terror. But terrorists are not 100-foot-tall ninjas that shoot lasers out of their eyes. They're mostly sad losers who screw up a lot. Terrorism is not a leading cause of mortality in America. I mean, it sucks, right? Terrorism sucks. I'm not a fan of terrorism. I live in London, and on July 7th, 2005, terrorists blew up the train my wife rode to work every morning and the bus I rode to work every morning. And it just happened, I was teaching in Michigan that day, and so my wife slept in because no one was there to wake her up. Otherwise, that would have been my bus and my wife's train. But let's keep things in perspective. even if you think that terrorism is a specially bad kind of thing that needs to be fought much harder than things that really kill the hell out of people in the continental United States, like car crashes or obesity or climate change, the algorithmic detection of terrorists is a statistical nonsense, thanks to many complex factors, but mostly something I call the, well, mathematicians call the paradox of the false positive, which is really easy to understand, although it has a very grandiose name. Let's be generous and say that there are 10,000 bona fide flame-throwing terrorists in America today, meaning that an astonishing 1 in 40,000 Americans or so is a fifth columnist plotting mass destruction, which is like decimal 0.025% of Americans. Now, say that you have a magic algorithm that detects terrorism with 99% accuracy. Just hook it up, collect it all, and it will automatically sort through the nation's driving records and texting patterns and web search history and barf up your enemies list. And you run it on the 350, 400 million Americans. And remember, there are 10,000 actual terrorists out there, and the 99% accurate algorithm will make one mistake out of every 100 judgments that you subject it to, which is what 99% accurate means, 1% inaccurate. And so the algorithm will identify 1% of Americans as terrorists, 35,000, 40,000 of them, or 3-4 million of them. You know what they say, when you fish for tuna with a dolphin, or with a dragnet, you catch a couple of dolphins. For every terrorist you catch with your 99% accurate system, you're catching 39,999 non-terrorists. If this sounds familiar, it's because it's how the stupid no-fly list works, and that's why it's got hundreds of thousands of names on it. Put it another way, if you want to find a needle in a haystack, it doesn't make any sense to start by making the haystack as big as you possibly can. Now, if catching terrorists is not the official good reason for spending billions on this nightmarish blend of Orwell and Kafka, then what is? Well, I asked some people about it. I asked Tom Drake and William Binney, who are the two of the celebrated NSA whistleblowers who preceded Ed Snowden. And they said they thought maybe it was civil service empire building. That if you're in charge of the NSA, your stature in government and your ability to command high-paid private sector jobs after you leave government service are a factor of the budget that you command, the number of reports who are under you in your org chart. So maybe that's a possibility. After all, when Keith Alexander retired from the NSA, he set up a private security consultancy where each of his clients are asked to pay $1 million a month for his advice on security, which in theory only includes non-classified, non-sensitive information that he didn't learn in government. So maybe that's it. Maybe it's civil service empire building. Or maybe, and this is kind of a weird one, but maybe it's the Sermon on the Mount, the bit where Christ says that God has his eye on the sparrow when it falls from the tree. It turns out that this is like a very old dream, the idea that you could, if you could see everything that happened, if you knew everything that happened in the world, you could find all the bad things and you could stop them from happening or make sure that the people who did them were adequately punished. That knowing everything about what everyone is doing all the time, that's an intuitively very seductive idea. It would make you a man like a god, literally, in our conception of what it has meant to be a god for the last 2,000 some years. So maybe it's that. Or maybe we're collecting it all because of pork. Most of what spooks do, they do through networks of private contractors, like Snowden's former employer, Booz Hamilton, or Seattle's own Amazon with its CIA cloud. The pork problem is really easy to understand. It's just economics 101. The beneficiaries of pork, the military-industrial complex with their billions in government contracts, they receive all the benefits from their graft in this highly concentrated form. They get tons of money to provide these services. And huge profits get raked off of this procurement system. And some of those profits, instead of being dispersed to shareholders, are set aside for lobbying. The Senate race that we're in the middle of has tons of black money in it, more black money than any other race in American history. This anonymously sourced super PAC money that can be spent without limitation thanks to a recent Supreme Court case called the Citizens United decision that held that political spending was a form of protected speech under the First Amendment. So that lobbying translates into a less rigorous procurement system. That's what you lobby for if you're a beneficiary of a sloppy, loose procurement system that fire hoses billions in taxpayer money on you. You can take some of that money and ask the government to give you an even less discriminating and less well-managed procurement system. And so you get more boondoggle surveillance programs. Meanwhile, all of the costs of the system are diffused. The erosion of the democratically necessary space to conduct your private life in private, the dolphins wriggling in that tuna net denied the right to fly or maybe secretly targeted for punitive blacklisting, the corrosion of social cohesion arising from that universal suspicion, the fact that your neighbor might be spying on you or that someone down the road might know something about you that you don't want them to know, those costs are borne by everyone. So you have the benefits concentrated in a few hands and the costs spread out for anyone. For any one of us, the costs are small enough that it's not economically sensible for us to fight back hard enough to make a difference against the concentrated power of the private sector spooks. Right? It makes sense for them to spend 10% of their time and money and energy to lobby for a better system to make them more money, but for any one of us, it would be a full-time job to tilt against that windmill. So maybe that's it. Maybe it's just externalities, what economists call externalities. Or maybe it's a different kind of economic phenomenon. Thomas Piketty's theory, documented in last summer's best-selling economic blockbuster, The Destroyer of Forests, we know as Capital in the 21st Century, all 700 pages of it. Piketty lays out a theory that markets left on their own tend to produce multi-generational financial dynasties, people whose children are rich because their parents were rich, and that these fortunes are able to sustain themselves without the families that control them actually contributing anything to society. And that the modern condition, the thing that we think of as kind of the signal achievement of modernism, of progress, of the time since the Enlightenment, where people get rich by making wonderful things that improve the world, that was a blip, an aberration in the history of the human race, made possible in America first because America was founded without a lot of big reserves of capital, because most of the capital at the time of the founding of the so-called New World was immobile. You couldn't bring it with you. And then also made possible in Europe because so much of the dynastic fortunes assembled in Europe over the centuries were destroyed in the orgies of destruction that we call World War I and World War II. And then by 1980 or so, enough money had kind of accumulated into a small enough number of hands that we got Pinochet, Reagan, Thatcher, Mulroney, and the reforms that followed from them through which fortunes got bigger and bigger because we had deregulation and other policy adventures that favored the investor class at the expense of people whose wealth is derived from making stuff, doing stuff. Piketty, in his book, all the way through it, he's haunted by the guillotine. And he returns to it over and over again. And he uses as a benchmark for how unequal a society might be, how unequal society was at the eve of the French Revolution. Because he seems to think that when that social unrest reaches its tipping point, out come the guillotines. So viewed through Piketty's lens, you can think of mass surveillance as just part of a cost-benefit analysis on the part of the 1%. Who've looked at the social instability of massive wealth disparity and decided that rather than kind of chipping off chunks of their fortune to create a middle class like we got after World War II, it's cheaper to just create this highly automated form of guard labor in the form of mass surveillance, and then secondarily you could see things like the militarization of our police forces. And I think that if you asked Americans, do you think that's what's happening in Saudi Arabia, or with Bashar al-Assad, or in the with kleptocratic, autocratic strongmen of the former Soviet Union, like Vladimir Putin, or the surveillance-crazed and terribly corrupt regimes of African states like Ethiopia, the first turnkey surveillance state, or the legendarily intrusive Chinese state, are the reason these states so power-mad, so surveillance-happy, so willing to crack down on even seemingly minor street protests with terrible violence, is it because the rulers have so much to lose and everyone else has so much to gain by upending the system? I think most Americans would say, oh, that makes sense. Of course that's why they're cracking down in Hong Kong. Of course that's why in Liberia and in other corrupt African states there's so much willingness to punish the official opposition and to spy on them and so on, because the only way the privileged can hold on to their power is by either redistributing their wealth so that the privilege is widely distributed so nobody wants to knock them over to take what they have, or by spying on and controlling everyone who lives there. But there's a certain discomfort in ascribing this motive to the United States and to its major allies like the US and Australia and Canada, or the UK, Australia and Canada, and so on. Whatever the cause, the Snowden documents demonstrated the facts on the ground that are deeply disturbing for anyone who cares about the fundamental hypothesis of the democracy, namely that a state becomes legitimate because it has the consent of the people who are governed by it. And that consent is expressed through the democratic process that includes debate, and that debate is not just public, but also private. Also, collective action and campaigning, including street demonstrations and civil disobedience and other forms of vigorous disagreement. Because spied upon populations are populations where all of those freedoms are severely curtailed. As Cardinal Richelieu wrote, going back to our French Revolution, "Give me six lines in the hands of an honest man, and I will find in them a reason to hang him." That is, if you do enough surveillance and you have a sufficiently complex system of laws, anyone can be made guilty. And because legitimate dissent is often viewed as treason at the moment, from MLK to Mandela, from Thomas Paine to George Washington, from Stonewall to Steinem, today's heroes were often yesterday's dangerous criminals. There are traitors and our terrorists. And because the idea that if you have nothing to fear, you have nothing to hide, is the ultimate expression of privilege. If you happen to have been born healthy, straight, cis, rich, and white enough that you have nothing to hide, it's not because you have any particular virtue. It's not because you've lived a life free from sin. It's because you won the lottery and you didn't earn it. And you owe it to your sisters and your brothers, your children and your aunts and your uncles and your cousins and your comrades who didn't win that lottery to use your privilege to give them the privacy that you claim that you don't need, but which every woman escaping an abusive spouse, every child wanting to report sexual abuse, every whistleblower exposing corruption does need. There has always been an activist community alive to the possibilities of networked computerized spying. There's a kind of revisionist history we tell ourselves now, that in the beginning, there were the cyber utopians who thought that the internet would make us all free and equal. And it wasn't until the serious policy people started to look at what the internet was doing maybe 5 years ago that those utopians finally had to confront what grown-ups should have known from the beginning, which is that if you give powerful people the tools to spy on everything that you do, they might just spy on everything that you do. But the Electronic Frontier Foundation's first case, its defining moment in 1992, was defending a case that said that email shouldn't be retrieved by the police without a warrant. And then it went on to win one of the most important cases we have for privacy, which is the Bernstein case. So in the olden days, it used to be that strong cryptography, the thing that we use to scramble messages so that the NSA and the police and the mafia and abusive spouses can't read your email, that strong cryptography was classed as a munition. And its export from the United States, or its use, was classed as like sort of banding around nuclear missiles or sending cluster mines to people without making a large enough political donation first. And lots of arguments were advanced for why this was a terrible policy. For example, the NSA said we have a less strong version of crypto that everyone in America can use because only the NSA can break it, and we'll only do it with a warrant. And they said that this is sufficient, and like spies will never break it, the mafia will never break it, our banks can use it, our financial institutions, our schools, our hospitals can use it. And a guy named John Gilmore, is called DES 50. A guy named John Gilmore is one of the founders of EFF. He built a cracker for DES 50 for $250,000. That could break DES 50 in a couple of hours. So whatever secret you are protecting with DES 50, the entire American banking system, the entire investment that you would need to completely own that from asshole to appetite, $250,000 and 2 hours, right? And the courts didn't care. They advanced arguments about how other countries would have good crypto and America wouldn't, and how America would lag those countries, and the courts didn't care, and the policymakers didn't care. But then, a mathematician named Daniel Bernstein at UC Berkeley published strong ciphers on the internet, on Usenet, the thing that we had for exchanging messages before we had YouTube comments. And he published these, And the Electronic Frontier Foundation, who are often accused of being dangerous cyber optimists who didn't foresee what was coming, the Electronic Frontier Foundation defended his First Amendment right to publish code on the grounds that code was a form of expressive speech, and won. And that's why we have strong crypto today. And in 2005, an AT&T engineer named Mark Klein walked into the Electronic Frontier Foundation's offices, which were then on Shotwell Street in San Francisco, and he said, "My job before I left AT&T was at the Folsom Street Switching Center, where one of AT&T's major fiber trunks for America goes through. And my boss had me put a beam splitter in that fiber optic trunk and run a copy of the internet off for the NSA in a secret room. And since 2005, EFF has been suing the government to get information about this." So there is the cyber utopian history is, to my mind, largely an imaginary one. There have been people who've been exuberant about the future. There's no crime in being exuberant about the future, so long as you're alive to the possibility that unless you intervene in special ways, the future might not be as bright as you hope it would be. It's one thing to be hopeful about the future, it's another thing to be naive about it. And I don't think EFF and the other so-called cyber utopians were naive. But privacy has always been a tough sell. Not least because privacy is in that class of problems that we have where the cause and the effect are separated by a lot of time and space. Back in the old days of film cameras, the average American family was shooting two rolls of film a year, one on holidays and one at Christmas and birthdays. And when you got your pictures back from the photo processing lab, you go through them and you go, well, that's a good one, and that's a crappy one, and that's a good one, and that's a crappy one. But unless you kept careful notes, you had no idea what you did to make the good ones different from the crappy ones. And Americans as a population did not progress in the art of photography particularly in that period. As you can see from just looking at, you know, go and look at your grandparents' photo albums and look at a generation of photos, and they're the same proportion of fingers in the shot and heads cut off and terrible composition and glowing red eyes from the flash as there ever were from generation to generation, right? We had this long static period of photography. And then we got the digital camera, which for whatever its initial demerits were, and it was much lower resolution than those film cameras, showed you your picture as soon as you took it. And by closing the feedback loop between action and effect, it turned people into such good photographers that there have now been several businesses that have been sold, one for several billion dollars, whose main appeal was that they would make your photos look more like snapshots from the olden days. Because the pictures we take today, we've gotten so good, they look like they may have been Sears portraits. They look like they might belong in a catalog because we've all become good at composition. We've all become good at figuring it out. We've all become better photographers because we closed the feedback loop. But that's not what happens with privacy. You make a disclosure with privacy, and most of the time nothing bad happens. But if you make enough disclosures, something bad will happen, like smoking a cigarette, right? Most puffs on a cigarette will do nothing, but enough puffs on a cigarette will give you cancer. Most privacy disclosures will do nothing, but enough privacy disclosures will yield up one that'll come and bite you in the ass eventually. And it means that it's very hard to figure out which kinds of privacy disclosures you should and shouldn't be making. And this is not a phenomenon new to the internet. When I was in the third grade, I had a teacher who, many people, went into the hospital with his wife for their baby to be born. And their baby was born, and as was the custom then in Canada, marketing companies would trawl the maternity wards with baskets of everything you needed for a newborn, cream and powder and diapers and onesies and bottles and everything you needed, all given up by consumer packaged goods companies in the hopes that you would then become brand loyal to them. The life cycle of marketing that Procter & Gamble invented is really like, this is its kind of most clear expression, because when people's lives change, they form new associations with products. They change toothpaste when they move out of their parents' house, or they figure out what brand of diapers they're going to buy when they have their first kid, and then they just sort of stick with it unless something drastic changes. And so that made sense to go around and give away these baskets. And to kind of seal the deal, the people who gave you the baskets said, "We just want your name, the kid's name, date of birth, address. We're going to send you coupons, you know, and stuff. We'll stay in touch. Right, please uncheck this box if you don't want to stay in touch. We know what that offer looks like." And so this is a thing that Canadians did that year. Most Canadians who had babies probably did that year. And like some fraction of those parents who had babies that year, my teacher's baby died a few weeks later. which happens sometimes. It's very sad. And every year on that baby's birthday, he got a set of coupons for the things that baby might need, right? Now, it's hard to see how he could have anticipated that outcome. I mean, you know, empirically, that outcome might have been one that could have gone through his mind. But what kind of monster is it who, holding their newborn on the maternity ward when confronted with a basket of useful things for your baby, thinks, but what if my kid dies, right? And what lesson did he learn from that? Like, how did that make him better at privacy, having learned that very hard lesson? How do you generalize that into other privacy contexts? So it's very hard to make people care about privacy. And so over the years that the internet has grown up, the questions that we've had about privacy have become more pointed and more urgent. And now we've had Snowden, and we've got some movement on this. Because the Pew study, 3 months after Snowden came out of the cold, last September 2013, surveyed American attitudes about privacy in the internet, and they found that an absolutely incredible 87% of Americans had taken some affirmative step to protect their privacy in the 3 months since Snowden, which suggests to me that if we haven't reached peak surveillance, we've reached peak indifference to surveillance, right? That people, there will never be a time after this in which fewer people think that it's creepy that you want to know everything that they're doing. Now, of course, nothing that those 87% of the people who did something, none of it worked. Because there's nothing, there's no tick box in your Facebook dash that gives you privacy from Facebook. The reason that there's so many tick boxes in your Facebook dash isn't because there's 1,000 ways to get privacy from Facebook. It's the same reason there's 27 different lines on the craps table, so you can't figure out the odds, right? But we can do things to give people privacy. We can use that cryptography that actually works to give people privacy. And Snowden, who's the only person who knows who's talking, says that the NSA can't break crypto, that they can do things like subvert the operating system so that the crypto, before and after the stuff is enciphered, it's siphoned off to the NSA, but the actual math is intact. Now, historically, tools that are cryptographically oriented, like PGP for email or OTR for chatting, or whole disk encryption, these things have been super wonky and kind of complicated and technical and hard to use. I find them hard to use. Other people have found them hard to use too. But I don't think that that's intrinsic to them. I think that the reason that crypto is kind of hard to use is the same reason that desktop publishing software was hard to use before the desktop publishing revolution. Because desktop publishing assumed, or typesetting software assumed, that everyone who wanted to typeset was a trained typesetter. That was a fair assumption before desktop publishing came along. And cryptography assumes that anyone who understands the internet well enough to know why their privacy matters is probably already pretty nerdy, right? But a few years into the desktop publishing revolution, and most of what we think of as typesetting is something that's accessible to everyone. Now, there's an irreducibly complex 2 or 3% of the typesetting chore that makes the difference between something beautiful and something anodyne. But between the hand-lettered sign and, that new book from McSweeney's I have out there that happens to be very beautifully typeset, between that there's a lot of room for things that you and I might decide to do with our computers that's perfectly adequate typesetting. And between having no privacy at all through cryptography and having the kind of total bulletproof operational security that even if you were Ed Snowden, the NSA couldn't break it, between there is a lot of useful room for securing our privacy. And there are tools emerging in the face of that 87% demand for those tools that do this. There's tools like Blackphone. There's protocols now, federated protocols for secure email. There's Simply Secure, a nonprofit whose advisory board I've joined that is devoted to making open source and free front ends for traditional tools that are aimed at a more usable way of using it. Or Wickr, an instant messaging company that does what Snapchat claims it does, but actually does it. And my full disclosure here, I'm on their advisory as well. But there's a serious threat to this very welcome news that we are having an explosion of tools aimed at normal people to help them have their privacy. It's something I've talked about before. I called it the war on general purpose computers. Because computers have a unique property that distinguishes them from all the technologies that came before them, which is the combination of both complexity and general purposeness. We're accustomed to general purpose things, wheels, right? No regulator, no matter how mad, has ever said, well, all the bank robbers drive cars, can't you make me a wheel that can't be used in a bank robbery, right? Because we understand that complicated things are generally generally special purpose, but simple things. So the whole car is special purpose. You could say, make me a car without a car phone in it. But the wheel itself, that general purpose wheel, is simple and therefore not amenable to regulation, and not the place where you should cite your regulation if you want to do something useful out of it. But computers have both of these things. They are both complicated and general purpose. Computers have this almost mystical property that Alan Turing identified after the Second World War, when he was designing with von Neumann, the other early computer scientists and pioneers, the first general purpose computers. It's called Turing completeness. It's that we know how to make computers that can do one or two things. Like if you want to make a thing that calculates ballistic tables or tabulates elections, we know how to make that electrical computer by wiring it up so it just does that one or two tasks. And we know how to make a Turing complete computer that can run every single program that can be expressed in symbolic language. But we don't know how to make any of the computers in between. We don't know how to make computers that are mostly Turing complete. And in fact, whenever we try, we usually come a cropper. So one of the big projects of computer scientists and programmers is to build toy programming environments that just do a few things and not all the things. Right? Like, you want to give your users a little scripting environment so they can put dancing unicorns on their social media homepages. Right? And you want them to put dancing unicorns but nothing else. And so you write a programming language that just does two or three simple things. And then next year at Black Hat or at CCC or at DEF CON, someone shows up and gives a presentation and says, you know those two or three little programming commands that you gave? I use them painstakingly to build up a full suite of programming tools, and I've written a virus in unicorn language over and over again, right? It turns out Magic the Gathering, the collectible card game, is Turing complete if you have enough cards and you don't care how long your program takes to run. Now, this poses significant regulatory problems, because most of what we think of as traditional regulatory questions have turned out to be questions about regulating computers. Like, if you want to stop a 3D printer from printing a gun, you need to design a computer that can run all the programs except for the one that prints out a gun. Or if you want to stop robotic cars from drag racing, you need to design a computer that can race cars but not run the, or that can drive cars but not race them. Or if you want to design a computer that can run a software-defined radio that can change its frequency depending on what code it's loaded in, but you don't want people's baby monitors to accidentally become air traffic control radios, you need to design a computer that can do that too. Now, historically, we just solved this with rules about what kind of device you could or couldn't make. Like, the FCC would literally say, oh, you're making a baby monitor. You can solder this quartz crystal on the board, but not that one, right? Problem solved. But that doesn't work in the realm of computers. And to see what it looks like when we try it, I'm going to ask you to think briefly about the copyright wars, which is a subject that I'm, no matter how tedious you find it, I find it more tedious. But we need to go there in order to talk about this. So you remember that around the mid-90s, we started to get computers that told us that they wouldn't obey us. The first among them was the DVD player, where you would put a disc in from another country and it would say, I'm not allowed to play that disc, or you would press skip during the fake FBI warning. Like, I love the idea that there's a division of the FBI that just writes stern language on behalf of the movie studios. And they would try to do that, or that you couldn't rip your DVD. You put it in your computer and you try to rip it and your computer would say, I don't know how to do that. And they tried to solve the problem of people doing undesirable things with their computers using cryptography, which incidentally is another Alan Turing thing. Alan Turing is like the author and the of both our sorrow and our delights here. In cryptography, we talk about these three people who are locked in an eternal love triangle, Alice, Bob, and Carol, or maybe Clapper. And Alice and Bob like each other, and they want to talk to each other, and they don't trust Clapper, and they don't want him to listen in on them. And so Alice and Bob want to send each other messages, and they think that Clapper can probably read those messages or see them as they go between Alice and Bob, because Alice and Bob assume that their messages are maybe going over radio, which anyone with a tuner can receive, or over satellite, where anyone on an entire continent in a tuner can receive it, or the public internet, where there are innumerable people who might be either incompetent or evil and let your data leak out. So they know that Clapper can read, can see their messages. They also assume that Clapper knows how they scramble their messages, because only a fool comes up with her own cryptographic algorithm. Now, to understand why, it sounds weird on its face, right? Like, why wouldn't you design your own system to be secure instead of letting your enemies know what system you're using? And to understand it, we just have to think about the Enlightenment. So before the Enlightenment, we had like 500 years of stuff that looked like science called alchemy. All the alchemists wanted to figure out how to turn lead into gold. None of the alchemists wanted the other alchemists to discover it first, because they knew enough about economics to know that once one person could turn lead into gold, no one else would be able to get rich doing it, because that person would flood the market with gold and that would be the end of it. So they all kept what they learned to themselves. And every alchemist discovered for himself in the hardest way possible that drinking mercury was a terrible idea. Because the human capacity for self-deception is endless. And then they started publishing, right? They started telling other people what they learned. They created the adversarial system of peer review, which is to say, you idiot, you forgot the decimal place, right? And when they started publishing, alchemy turned into science. We call that moment the Enlightenment. Now, Bruce Schneier says anyone can design a security system that works so well that he himself can't think of a way of breaking it, right? In other words, your homebrew security system only works against people who are stupider than you. And since it's vanishingly unlikely that you're the smartest person in the world, and even if you are, you can still make mistakes, we tell other people how our crypto systems work, right? And we tell them and we tell them and we tell them, make them as wide open as we can, and even then we miss bugs, right? We witness Heartbleed and Poodle and Shellshock, these three celebrated showstopper bugs in open source cryptographic tools that had been lurking for decades. And, you know, the idea that it's something special about open source is clearly wrong, right? The fact that the source code that no one's allowed to look at has no bugs in it is just a really unlikely hypothesis, as opposed to, like, the only people who know about the bugs in that code are the bad guys who aren't telling anyone, who are merrily exploiting it. And so we have Alice and Bob and Carol. Alice and Bob assume that Carol or Clapper know how they're scrambling the message, and that Clapper can get his hands on the enciphered message. But Clapper doesn't have the key. And so long as the crypto works, knowing everything except the key means you know nothing. You know that Alice and Bob are talking to each other, but you don't know what they're talking about. And so that's great, right? That works. That totally works. It's why your banking transactions are trustworthy. It's why you know the NSA can have secrets. But assuming the key doesn't leak, you're in good shape. But that's not how these digital locks that the DVDs use and that your iPhone uses to stop you from installing third-party software, or that your Kindle uses to stop you from translating your Kindle books to run on a Nook. That's not how that works. The way that those work is, I want to sell you an ebook, and I want to make sure that you only do things with the ebook that my software allows you to do, and not stuff that someone else's software allows you to do. So I give you some software, and I scramble the ebook, and I put the key in the software, and I don't trust you, so I put it in the software, and then I give the software to you and not the key. Maybe you've spotted the flaw in my reasoning here, right? Because I don't trust you, but I just gave you the key, although I put it in the software. But you, provided that one of you is smart enough to retrieve the keys, you can share it with everybody or make a program that can do what you're not supposed to do, and it's game over for me, right? And in this case, you just have Alice and Bob. And Bob doesn't trust Alice, but he wants Alice to be able to read the message, but only on terms of his choosing. And Alice isn't just one person. Alice is everybody in the world who could potentially want to get at whatever it is Bob is trying to lock up, right? It's the entire universe of people who might want to watch a movie on their own terms, including things like bored grad students with their own electron tunneling microscopes. So this stuff doesn't work, right? This stuff doesn't survive contact with reality. All of these digital rights management systems, all these digital locks that try to solve a social problem by limiting what a computer can do, are broken in an afternoon by bored teenagers, usually. One after another, not because the people who design them are fools. Some of them are extremely talented engineers and cryptographers, but it's because they're trying to do something impossible. They're trying to make water less wet, and it's not gonna work, and it won't work. So how do we solve that? Well, I mean, historically, lawmakers have been very sympathetic to the project of designing computers so that they stop their owners from doing the thing they're not supposed to do, because there's been this idea that we can solve our social problems by limiting computers. So in 1998, America passed the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, which was followed around the world by similar laws, usually enacted at the behest of the U.S. Trade Representative. And the Digital Millennium Copyright Act is a very complicated bill, but it contains in it a provision that criminalizes breaking these digital locks or telling people how to break the digital locks, because it's obvious that if your computer is designed to stop you from doing something that you want to do, and you know how your computer works, then you can change it so it doesn't stop you from doing what you want to do. And so there must be a prohibition on telling you how to break your lock and on telling you information that would be useful to break your lock. If you know how to break your lock, then the lock doesn't work anymore. If the lock is on something that belongs to you and it's in your living room and you have your full suite of tools and someone tells you where to stick the screwdriver to open it up, you will sure shoot and open it up. We don't keep bank vaults and bank robbers' living rooms for a reason, right? And so we created these rules and they had lots of bad effects. The one major effect of these rules was on the way that average people interacted with the computers around them, right? That was, and it was a grave impact, right? Like if you were someone who had a disability and you worked with a group like the National Institute for the Blind, in the years gone by, they might have just helped you adapt the technology in your house so that you could live a more full life. But once you put a digital lock on these things, it's impossible for those people to help you. And so those accessibility features were only there at the sufferance of the companies that designed the digital locks and not because someone who needed them added them herself or found someone to add them for her. And that goes double for people who live in contexts that aren't anticipated by the developers of the technology, who may not have a disability but may just live in different circumstances. People, for example, who live in the developing world of the global south often have needs that are different from the needs of people who live in the north. They may not have regular access to electricity or regular network access, and so we have a digital lock that phones home all the time to make sure that it is still allowed to run. If you have only intermittent access to the internet, you may find that your software seizes up altogether. It also deprived the developed world of access to some really important things that we need, which is the wisdom and cleverness and reliability and ingenuity of people in the developing world. It turns out that there are a lot of things that people in the developing world need that people in the developed world need too, right? Like Ubuntu, the most popular flavor of the GNU Linux open operating system, was designed for use in sub-Saharan remote schoolrooms. And the assumption was that there'd be intermittent electricity, that the hardware would fail and be swapped out all the time, so each time you boot it up, you might have different hardware, that there'd be no one around to do tech support, and that the internet wouldn't work a lot of the time. These also tend to describe the computing conditions of people who travel around a lot, like mobile executives, and also people who work in cash-strapped city schools around the world, including in the rich world. And this is why I use it, right? So we've been deprived of all that potential innovation that might come from our friends who live in circumstances other than ours from which we might benefit. And we've been deprived of value that was latent in our technology, and that's important too. If you buy CDs and you want to listen to them on your mobile device, you just rip them because there's no digital lock on the CD, so it's legal to make a tool like iTunes that rips it. If you buy DVDs, which you read and write with the same laser, you make them in the same factory, you read them in the same drive, and you want to watch them on your tablet, you either break the law or you buy them again. The latent value that would let you get more use out of your technology as other complementary technologies come on, you're deprived of that too. But that's not the major consequence of what happens when you solve social problems by regulating computers. The major consequence is to security and to privacy. And so this brings back the copyright wars around to what happens when we start to solve all of our computer problems, including our privacy problems with restrictions. And because it's obvious that if you can change a technology designed to control you, that you will, and because it's obvious that once there is a flaw in that technology that's widely known, it's an opportunity to figure out how to open up the lock, right? If there's a defect in the lock, then it's an opportunity to open up the lock. Governments made it against the law to report on defects and systems that have some role in allegedly protecting copyright, like the restrictions on your iPhone or the restrictions on your DVD player. And what that means is that you don't get to know about the bugs that emerge in these systems that you rely on. And what that means is that those bugs tend to lurk for a long time before they're disclosed, and they get exploited for a long time before they're disclosed. In 2005, Sony BMG, the record label, shipped out 6 million CDs, 51 titles. They shipped them around the world, and when you put these CDs in your computer CD drive, they stealthily changed your operating system so that it could no longer see programs or files that started with a certain string they made up, a certain combination of letters, $SYS$. Then they installed a program on your computer that started with that string that your computer couldn't see, that you couldn't find in your file listing and delete, that you wouldn't show up in your program listing so you could kill it, and that watched to see whether or not you were ripping a CD, and if it thought you were ripping a CD, it just killed whatever process it thought was ripping the CD. Now, because any file that started with that string was invisible to the operating system, it was invisible to your antivirus software too. And so immediately virus writers started prepending that string to their viruses, right? When you make, when you weaken something's immune system, it gets parasitic infections. All complex ecosystems have parasites. And so immediately viruses started to flood out that had this. Now, security researchers discovered the Sony rootkit, as it was called, months before it was disclosed, but they thought that they would be committing a felony if they disclosed it, because they might people who wanted to pirate their CDs, and they were worried of falling afoul of this. And in that time, 300,000 US government and military networks got the Sony rootkit, and an unknown number of them were therefore infected with these viruses that were not visible to them. And so this is what it means to make a computer that's Turing complete minus one, a computer that runs all the programs except for the one that you fear, the one that gives you a problem, is that you have to put a moat in its eye. You have to somehow design that computer so that the owner of the computer can't know what it's doing. And this should already be causing alarm for you, because the devices that entertain you have converged with the devices that you rely on for everything in your lives. Your phone knows everything about you, right? It knows who your friends are. It has a camera, it has a microphone, it knows what you talk about, it knows where you go, it knows the password and login for your bank, and it knows your password and login for your doctor, and it knows what your privileged confidential communications with your lawyer constitutes. And that computer is also designed to stop you from installing third-party software, because Apple wants to be sure that they get 30% of every sale of an app for your phone. And so they want to make sure that you can't install software from a rival store that might only charge software vendors 20%. It's this like super attenuated reason to try and lock down your computer. It's really weird, right? To make sure that like you only put approved bread in your toaster, you only put approved dishes in your dishwasher. They've designed it with this Baroque system of locks and opacity so that you can't know what it's doing. This is bizarre, but it's also alarming, because if you can't know about flaws in your iPhone, if they lurk without being reported even after they're discovered, then the potential for mischief is endless. The potential for invasions of your privacy is endless. And this is not limited to your mobile devices. Your laptop almost certainly also has software that is covered by these rules. And we've seen what happens when our laptops are compromised. If you're a celebrity, maybe your naked pictures show up all over the internet. You may have never even taken a naked picture, and you can still end up with naked pictures all over the internet. A woman named Cassidy Wolf, who was the Miss Teen USA of 2013, she was tricked into installing malicious software on her phone, on her laptop, that exploited a bug that hadn't been widely known, that hadn't been patched yet. And that software allowed her attacker to remotely activate her camera covertly. And like everybody else, she stands naked in front of her computer from time to time, because it sits on her desk as she's getting dressed. And he captured incidental nude images of her. And he captured her login and password for Facebook and her other social media accounts. And he blackmailed her. He threatened to publish her nude photos on her social media accounts unless she performed live sex acts on camera for him. And she called the FBI, and they found this guy. And he had over 140 victims all around the world, including minor children. And he was just one. There were lots of other people who do this. They call themselves ratters. A rat stands for remote access Trojan. A group of 100 ratters who were arrested earlier this year, some of them had as many as 400 victims around the world. So not being allowed to know about flaws in your computer is an enormous threat to the integrity of your life. And this is only the beginning. It's just the first skirmishes in the all-out war on general-purpose computing, because the conditions that led lawmakers to solve their problems through mandating that computers be designed to run all the programs except for one and then making it illegal to tell people how their computers work, those conditions still prevail, right? The FBI last week, 2 weeks ago, started calling for backdoors in mobile phones once Apple announced that they were going to be encrypting phones by default. Well, a backdoor is just a program that allows people who you don't trust to gain access to your data. It's a program you don't want. Nobody woke up this morning and said, I wish that my iPhone would only give my most private information to me, people I trust, and anyone who has a police login. And so the only way to maintain a backdoor on your phone is to make it illegal for you to report, to know about bugs in your phone, because those bugs can be used to close the backdoor, they can be used to run a jailbreak, and that means that your phone, leaving aside the privacy risks of the FBI knowing about vulnerabilities of your phone will inevitably come a long live reservoir of pathogens that can be used by everyone, not just the FBI, to attack you, and not just through the FBI's backdoor, but through new backdoors leveraged into it, like the ones that were used to attack Cassidy Wolf and the other victims of Ratters, because that's what vulnerabilities in your computer means. You may have seen earlier this month there was an amazing article in the New York Times, not in their tech section, in their finance section, about subprime auto lending, which is the done thing now. Now that everyone's fortunes that were big enough to do subprime house buying have been transferred into the pockets of Wall Street, we're left with subprime car buying. And subprime car buying is enabled because you can fit a car with a governor and it's an ignition switch that has a GPS. And it has a two-way connection back to the finance company through the mobile phone network. And if you miss a payment, it locks out your ignition. Now, like, nobody wants this, right? And YouTube is full of videos explaining how to disable the disabler, right? How to remove the governor, right? Well, if the movie industry was able to secure a law prohibiting you knowing how to change your computer so that you can watch movies the wrong way, what is the likelihood that a finance industry in charge of billions of dollars in collateralized bonds, or the entire surveillance industry that has raised this moral panic about terrorism, won't be able to get a law that stops terrorists from closing the lawful interception backdoors in their phones, that stops car thieves from stealing cars? Computers are going to cause problems that scare and infuriate powerful enemies in our society. And backdoors have no allegiance. When you put a backdoor in, when you put anything that allows a remote party to override what you want, it doesn't just allow that party in, it allows anyone who can successfully impersonate the person who's supposed to come through the backdoor in. So in the mid-90s, the American government passed a law called CALEA that said that anyone who made a switch for switching data, a network switch, would have to design it so the police could do a phone tapping without actually going down to the place where the switch was and attaching a piece of equipment to it. They could log into a computer and say, when this number calls that number, I want to know about it and I want a recording. And not every country has this law, but because everyone who makes network switches wants to sell in America, all of them have this feature and you either turn it on or off when you turn the switch on. Well, in 2005, Greece was running an Olympic bid and someone, no one knows who, logged into Greece's switches, which did not have the CALEA backdoors turned on, and turned them on, and listened to Parliament and the Prime Minister, and then walked away. And Greece didn't get the Olympics. They did get those Olympics, but presumably their bid was compromised in some way. And in addition to that, there was huge amounts of potentially sensitive information leaked out to parties unknown. It's only because they didn't erase the log files on their way out of the servers that we know about this. We've seen lawful interception tools designed for the American market used by Gaddafi in Libya, by Assad in Syria. China used the lawful interception backdoors in Google's email system to hack Gmail and get information on its dissidents. And this is only going to get worse because the suite of tools that computers infest and colonize is only going to broaden from here on in. In 2012, a security researcher who passed away last year named Barnaby Jack gave a presentation on his work on implanted defibrillators, which are amazing technology. If you have the kind of heart that stops periodically, Rather than relying on someone being around to perform CPR, you can get a defibrillator implanted. Your doctor anesthetizes you, she spreads your ribs, reaches into your chest cavity, and attaches a battery with a computer to your heart. The computer listens to your heart beating, and when it stops, it gives you a jolt of electricity that keeps you alive. And doctors want to update the firmware on these things, and they want to check their telemetry, and they want to do all kinds of stuff with them, and it's kind of messy to attach a cable to a computer that's in your chest cavity. So they gave it a wireless interface, just like everything else we have today. And Barnaby Jack showed that from 30 feet away, he could take over that wireless interface, and he could cause it to administer lethal shocks to its owners. There's a great piece of YouTube video from researchers at the University of Michigan who attached a pacemaker to a piece of bacon and then took it over using its wireless interface and cooked the bacon. And it's not just that we have computers increasingly inside our bodies, we also have our bodies increasingly inside of computers. Once you install a Google Nest thermostat or another piece of home automation equipment, your house becomes a computer that you live in. And so you could imagine the Euromaidan protests of last year, how they might have shaken down if stingrays that were no doubt deployed in the square to get the phone identities of everyone in the square, which are now standard operating procedure for everyone who has a protest that they want to spy on, including American police. They harvest the unique identifiers of all the phones by impersonating a phone tower. If that could have been combined with a smart thermostat that was designed to take orders from remote parties, even if the person sitting at the thermostat disagreed. You know, you might want to send a message out that says, everybody turn your thermostat down by 2 degrees so we don't have to turn on the coal plant right now. Once you design that thermostat that way, then a dictator in a former Soviet basket case republic can take everybody who shows up at a protest in the dead of winter and turn their heat off that night. So science fiction writers have grappled with the question of whether technology is going to liberate us or enslave us since the time that Mary Shelley wrote Frankenstein. But I'm not very interested in that question because it's pretty clear to me that technology can do either of those things. And even if the answer was that technology will always take away our freedom, it's not like we could change that by abandoning technology. Technology is not a problem to be solved, it's a fact on the ground. The useful question is an optimism or a pessimism, because the future isn't foreordained. The future will change based on what we do. The question I'm interested in is, what do we do to make a difference? How do we intervene in the future to make a better one? Groups like the Open Rights Group in the United Kingdom, the Free Software Foundation, the Electronic Frontier Foundation, and the ACLU have been on the right side of this fight for a long time. The best legacy that we can hope for from Snowden is a commitment to tools that aren't just surveillance resistant, but are also corruption resistant, produced through means that are transparent and difficult to subvert, that fail well by making it impossible to bury the news that they've been broken. Because whether the surveillance is being conducted because of statistical illiteracy or civil service empire building or elite panic or just hubris, it is a scourge, it's an existential threat to our human freedom, and it must be stopped. So with that, I'll take your questions. Thank you. So I'll remind you before your questions that long rambling statements followed by "what do you think of that" are technically questions but not good ones. And I will, to the extent as is possible, alternate genders in calling on people. So, yes, sir.
You spoke a lot about government surveillance, but you didn't mention much about corporate surveillance.
Mm-hmm.
That's the kind of information that's being harvested about us by Google.
Sure. What's the relationship between private surveillance and public surveillance? I think that they're very intimately related. In fact, I don't think you can talk about one without talking about the other. So to the extent that states believe that it's legitimate to spy on everyone, they will never pass a law limiting the power of the companies who pay for the surveillance to spy on us, right? The fact that GCHQ could tap 2 or 3 big fiber optic lines and get almost all of the world's data traffic was not by design, but because of regulatory capture that allowed just a few phone companies to end up running all of the main fiber trunks in the world. The happy accident of that was that you only had to subvert 2 or 3 executives at 2 or 3 companies to get access to everybody's fiber optic. I think that unless we can check government surveillance, we have no hope of checking corporate surveillance. Now, I think that good tools, tools that stop the state from spying on us, will also help us prevent ourselves from being spied on by companies. And I think that Larry Lessig's way of thinking about this, he talks about there being four forces that regulate us, markets, norms, law, and code, that all four of those need to fire together. So I think that the reason that Silicon Valley opted for the surveillance business model is not an ideological commitment to surveillance. I think that when you hear Silicon Valley executives saying, if you don't want people to know what you're doing, maybe you shouldn't be doing it, or privacy is dead, those are not like heartfelt beliefs. They're just sort of code for, I would be richer if everybody thought this. You know, the reality is that Silicon Valley investment firms are totally without ideology, except it would be nice to be richer. And so they will happily play both sides of the surveillance wars. And the fact that 87% of Americans tried to use a product that didn't exist last September is a wake-up call to an industry so concerned with chasing margins that they'll put a $14 billion valuation on a company like Uber that may turn out not to be legal. And so I see tons of investment flooding into anti-surveillance technologies that do equal duty when it comes to both private and public style surveillance. I do think that there's a real question about how we do public education around the public health problem of people being not well equipped to understand the privacy costs of a disclosure today, kind of pricing the net present value of a privacy disclosure that whose problem might be long in the future. And you know, historically, we try to solve public health problems with public health education campaigns, right? And we do that a bit with our private surveillance. Our schools teach a kind of scare tactic, Red Scare / Reefer Madness version of privacy, where they say, you know, just don't use Facebook. Like, just don't put stuff on Facebook, which is actually not bad advice. You know, I'm a Facebook vegan, but it's hardly practical advice for a lot of people. And what's worse is it's accompanied by another kind of surveillance, which is the censoring proxies that all schools use under a Clinton-era law. All institutions that receive federal funding need to try and stop people from looking at pornography, basically. And so they buy these filters that are run by companies that mostly make filters to help repressive regimes stop their citizens from seeing information about how rotten they are. And they repurpose them with huge lists of web pages compiled by like boiler rooms full of blue noses who have embarked on the thankless task of sorting the good internet from the bad internet, which are hopelessly out of date and inaccurate and idiosyncratic. And then every click that every student makes is relayed to these war crimes companies to make sure that it doesn't appear on the list of bad web before it's either released or blocked. And so we sit there and we tell our students, your privacy is as precious as your virginity, and once it's lost, you'll never get it back. And you must take every step you can conceive of to stop Mark Zuckerberg, who is indeed a creep, from knowing everything about you. But if you take any single affirmative step to protect your privacy from me or the shadowy contractors who do my dirty work, you're expelled, right? And it's like trying to convince your kids not to smoke while you're lighting one from the stub of the last one before putting it out in the ashtray. Your actions speak louder than your words. And so I think that we inhabit this era of contradictions about privacy that make it really hard to achieve privacy goals, where we have these, what economists call moral hazards, where the state relies on, in order to throw like red meat to frighten parents, relies on total surveillance of children. And in order to you know, fulfill other needs that it has, you know, empire building or statistical literacy or even more red meat to people frightened of terrorists, it has to spy on everybody else. And so they're never going to tell companies to stop spying, and they're never going to tell schools to stop spying or to help kids do what schools really should be doing. You know, if you wanted to give good privacy-oriented curriculum to kids, you would teach them to jailbreak every device, circumvent every firewall, right? I mean, that's what privacy literacy is, right? Those are the self-help measures. That's the normative piece of norms, code, laws, and markets. And our schools are not teaching the normative piece of it. They're actually teaching the inverse norm which is a huge problem. And it's not just schools, it's libraries, it's all federally funded institutions. Yes? We should give them
a fire hose.
So anonymity plus a fire hose. So that I think what you're saying is if we just didn't identify whose information was whose, but it was all in this sort of cacophonous mess, that they wouldn't be, that it would be like when you're watching everyone, you're watching no one. That they wouldn't ever be able to tell that it was you who said, you know, the doctor called it herpes or whatever. Not that you ever said that, but you, I have no special knowledge. They would just know that someone somewhere had said that. The problem is that it's extremely, that information is very re-identifiable. I'll come back to you. That information is very re-identifiable. Like designing computers that aren't Turing complete, designing anonymized data sets also seems to be one of those transcendentally hard problems. You can have anonymity within K people. But eventually, one of those people, in one of their messages, is going to say something like, call me later, it's Bob, and this is my phone number, right? And then the identifying conclusively which person is talking within that group becomes a lot easier. And so I think that you're right that having some self-help measures, right, having self-help measures that preserve our anonymity is good, but I think that in addition to that, we should also be aiming for privacy, and not just privacy through technological means, although that's important, but through the rule of law, right? But these projects are entwined, right? The case for the rule of law protecting our privacy derives in part from the technical possibility, right? From having crypto that even the NSA can't break, that normal people know how to use. Not that the NSA couldn't break if they shone their spotlight on you personally and broke into your house and put a keylogger in your computer, but that they can't break for free, right? Like every new Gmail user costs Prism nothing. And so adding a new Gmail user to the Prism database costs effectively nothing. So if there was some technical thing that made it harder for our privacy to be compromised, normatively, it would make the act of compromising our privacy more looked down upon. And legally, it would be more plausible to then say, you know, the people will not stand for the idea that there is this widespread surveillance. And commercially, there will be markets for tools to protect your privacy. So you get all four of those forces working together and you get change. But I think that saying, we should let the NSA collect everything by gum because there's no way we're ever going to stop the NSA from doing what they want, is counsel of despair. Like, if we can't control the NSA and stop them doing bad stuff, then they will do bad stuff that no amount of tools will help us with. Like, for example, they'll subvert those tools, or they'll, you know, do what we've seen states do so far, which is like create markets in 0 days, where they states are now buying bugs, vulnerabilities, and rather than reporting them and having them fixed, they're hoarding them and weaponizing them and using them to attack people. And even if they only ever attack bad guys, every bug that they know about that they don't immediately set out to patch is a bug that someone else might independently discover and use to attack everybody in the nation, right? You can't have cybersecurity for a country if you're not telling people about the bugs that are in their mission critical equipment. And like there's like real world evidence that this happens. So the tailored access operations manual from the NSA that was leaked by the other NSA leaker that wasn't Snowden, as near as anyone can tell, that was presented at Chaos Communications Congress last year in Hamburg, Jake Applebaum presented it, and he said, like, here's this catalog full of exploits that the NSA technical people provide to their operatives if they want to spy on someone. Here's one that exploits a bug in Apple's iOS, their iPhone, iPad operating system that they weaponized and used. Yesterday, unbeknownst to me, without any planning, another security researcher stood on another stage in this building and presented this bug because he'd found it and weaponized it, and he presented it to prove that there was this flaw in iOS to get Apple to patch it. So if he discovered it and the NSA discovered it, what is the likelihood that no one else discovered it and wasn't exploiting it to attack people who had these pluripotent devices in their pockets. So unless we can rein in the NSA, right, unless we can have the rule of law governing the NSA, then what that system that you're describing is the thing that the guerrillas use to topple the government and make a better one, not a stable state that you accept as kind of the status quo. Yeah? Yeah, so how do we get the rule of law when Congress doesn't even know what the NSA is doing? Or more broadly, when Congress, even when they do know what the NSA is doing, aren't allowed to talk about it, as Ron Wyden wasn't for many years. Or you know, we see now with the CIA torture memo that the CIA spied on its congressional minders and impersonated congressional staffers and looked to be set to walk away from that scot-free. How do we get lawmakers to make what you might broadly call evidence-based policy? And this is a question that many people are concerned with, obviously. The leading theory of why policy isn't evidence-based is that the great disparity in wealth means that a very small number of people benefit extraordinarily from certain kinds of policy outcomes, like, for example, companies that do private security contracting, private surveillance contracting, benefit extraordinarily from loose regulation of the surveillance industry, and so we get these bad outcomes. Now, Lawrence Lessig, who was one of the first scholars to start writing about issues around copyright and free speech and so on, he gave up on all those fights because he said, you know, we go and we make the evidentiary case for a better policy around the way the internet works. And what we get back is just silliness, right? Stuff that has like no reasonableness on its face, and yet it just keeps happening, and it keeps happening in the service of companies that have loads and loads and loads of money. So, you know, is there a mystery there, or is it obvious what's going on? And so Lessig, you know, he's basically said, okay, well, we need to get the money out of the election cycle. So he started a super PAC that funds candidates that will agree to vote for policies that will abolish super PACs. And it's called Mayday PAC. They raised $6 million between June 1st and July 4th this year, and they're going to run four or five campaigns, and then they're going to use what they've learned to prototype a wider suite of campaigns that'll be a whole slate in the next election cycle. So, I mean, maybe that's the way that we solve it. I think that solving the internet problem in parallel with the corruption problem is really important, because I think that while there are lots of other problems out there that are more important in a kind of global sense, whether that's, you know, Ebola or child soldiers in the CAR or rape camps or whatever, that all of those fights will be fought and won or lost on the internet. And so it's not the most important fight, but it's certainly the most foundational. Did you still have a question, or did it get covered? Okay. Okay. Sorry, I'm doing the...
I think we just have time for
one more. All right, go ahead. The Trans-Pacific Partnership. Sure, well, there's not much to say in as much as it's a secret, right? So this is, you know, if you want to talk about bad governance, we were talking about something else, and he said, do you think that these bad outcomes are a conspiracy or just like an emergent phenomenon of people just looking out for their own interests? And I think a lot of what comes out of Congress is just an emergent phenomenon. It's what happens when literally 4 hours out of every eight that you spend after you take office is spent phoning millionaires trying to get money for your reelection campaign. But the Trans-Pacific Partnership is, I think, satisfies every formal definition of a conspiracy, right? It's a trade agreement that's very broad, being negotiated without any public scrutiny, without any congressional or parliamentary scrutiny. All the parliaments and congresses involved, whose countries are negotiating, none of them are allowed to see the text of the language. The industry is affected by it. Their senior members do get to see it and get to be in the room while it's being negotiated. Anytime anyone's tried to inject not even transparency, but a modicum of accountability, like, for example, renting a room in the same hotel that TPP is being negotiated to hand out literature about alternatives to delegates to the conference, that they've shut them down and thrown them out of the hotel so that they no dissenting voice is allowed anywhere near them. And so the specifics have leaked at various times. WikiLeaks had a new draft out, and we don't know what the final draft is going to say. They're pretty terrible. They, I mean, most notably, they have this thing called corporate sovereignty, where other countries' companies can sue, companies can sue each other's governments to abolish laws that limit their profitability in the grounds that those laws are sort of unfair trade advantages. Canada just entered into a 30-year unbreakable agreement with China that has a corporate sovereignty clause, and it was done without any debate. It was entered into by the administration. So the Obama administration has the maintains the posture that this is purely the function of the USTR, the U.S. Trade Representative, and not a matter for Congress, although it totally constrains Congress's actions for the duration of America's participation in the treaty. And it's just one of many. There's a European one called TTIA. And really, it kind of doesn't matter what's in the treaty, because you know, everything you need to know you can tell from its formal characteristics, right? Just like nobody woke up this morning and said, I wish there was a way I could do less with my music. Maybe there's something Apple's got in that line for my mobile device. No one ever said, we want to make a treaty that will be broadly supported by everybody in all the countries affected, but let's keep it a surprise and negotiate it in secret so that everybody everybody will be pleasantly surprised. There's only one reason to go behind closed doors, right? And that's because what you're writing is not something that you believe would pass democratic muster. That was what happened with ACTA, which is the earlier rendition of TPP, and that's what seems to be happening with TPP and what's happening with TTIA and the Canada-EU trade agreement and all of the other multilateral and plurilateral and bilateral trade agreements that are negotiated in secret. There's really no reason to negotiate them in secret except to do something bad. Well, all right then. Thank you all very much.